So with no further ado, I want to introduce Brian Sovryn. He's the host of Sovryn Tech. He's also the distinguished only three-time panel host here at Keenevention over all the years. And, you know, who better to go to than a tech podcast host to host the tech panel, which is always an informative panel full of wonderful people who absolutely know a lot about the tech world. And I will let him introduce the panel to you. And good morning, Brian. Thanks for coming back to Keenevention.
Absolutely, my pleasure. Let's give a quick round of applause for the guests that are here, or the panelists that are already here. There it is. Absolutely, yes. Thank you for showing up at this ungodly hour. Don't worry, plenty of ungodly people here to get this tech panel on the road. Just a quick introduction of myself. Like Ian said, I am the host of the tech panel Sovryn Tech. That's SovrynTech.com. All that matters is that they spell your name right, right? And I've been running that show for about 3 years. Actually, a little over that. And it's been a real pleasure each year to be hosting the tech panel. Always great stuff coming out. And it's always different every year. Keenevention, I think, always has a different vibe every year. I wasn't able to catch all of it, but I assume everybody's been having a great time. At least that's what I've heard so far. And that's really exciting. Tech is such an important aspect, especially today. In fact, in a lot of ways, you know, some of our rights, our liberties, our freedoms can only be defended in today's world via tech, unless you want to go off, you know, into the woods. And I'm not begrudging anybody that. I think about doing that all the time. It's really, really important to get this stuff hammered out when it comes to privacy, when it comes to security, when it comes to creating things that where you don't even really have to combat the ideology, or not even the ideology, but the physicality of the state of infringements on our humanity. But you can actually just end run the whole system. And that's a very exciting concept to talk about. I heard there was a great Bitcoin panel here. Certainly that is definitely a major technology that may get briefly touched on during this panel. But there's a lot of things that I want to talk about, a lot of things that I think maybe you hadn't considered. Tech is important when it comes to jobs, because tech jobs allow you to have the freedom to perhaps move to New Hampshire. There's so many things to cover here, so I want to get right into it. And we've got a great lineup of panelists. I think we have more than perhaps the other panels had, but that's okay, because great people. So let's get them all, let's get their voices out there. Just let the panelists know, there's a series of questions. Not everyone may be asked each question, but if you really have something you want to get out there on about it, you can just kind of raise your hand, and perhaps I'll be a good school teacher and, you know, allow you to speak, because it's all about authority, right? No, not here. But do raise your hand if you really have a comment you want to get out there. So anyway, let's start this off. We'll start off with the lovely and hyper-intelligent Dr. Stephanie Murphy. If you want to introduce yourself and just give a brief overview of what you do, and then we'll get into the very first question.
All right, we're introducing ourselves here. Okay, so I think I'm on this panel because I'm Brian's girlfriend.
You'd be right. No.
But I also have a little bit to do with technology. I'm Stephanie Murphy. I am a voice actor, and I work in kind of the audio field right now, and I work for myself. I have an online business, created my own job and all that stuff, but I used to work in science, and so I've got a PhD in biochemistry. That's why he called me doctor, so I know a little bit about the biotech world as well, and I'm still, you know, I still do a couple of things in science-related activities, and also I'm the host of Let's Talk Bitcoin, which is a podcast about Bitcoin. And so I've been interested in Bitcoin since about 2011, and I'm really sad that I missed the Bitcoin panel on Friday. I was going to be a part of it, but they got Gavin to be on it, so I think that was a really cool. I can't wait to see the video. So yeah, Bitcoin, science, and audio, a little bit of an eclectic smattering of interest, but that's what I do.
Yeah, and I think certainly we'll get into the audio work that you do. I think that has a lot to say about the tech world in general. Jeremy, if you want to introduce yourself and what you do.
Sure. I'm Jeremy Kauffman. I think I'm up here because I'm involved in a couple of different technology companies. I started a company called TopScore. That's a software as a service for sport and activity organizations. It's used by a couple 100,000 people every year. And I'm also part of a new startup called LBRY. That's spelled LBRY, and that's creating a decentralized content marketplace, and that's been made possible by the insights of the blockchain.
Yeah, I think, in fact, I didn't know if you were just calling it LBRY or library, but I think that's definitely an exciting thing, and hopefully during this panel we will get to talking about that, because LBRY.io, that is pretty exciting stuff. Steve, if you want to introduce yourself, please.
I'm Steve Zemanek. I guess I'm here because I'm basically a behind-the-scenes activist, kind of. Always doing some of the tech behind the scenes.
This is the IT guy of the Keen activist movement. That's just a fact. And in fact, he's been on this panel every year along with me, and it's always great to have you on.
So I used to do small business consulting. I went into e-commerce for a little bit, and I just started a systems administration job at a dealership chain, a car dealership chain. So going to be ending up in Manchester, though.
In Manchester? Yeah. Wow. Well, they just, boy, that's like a number one draft pick there. All right. Yep.
All right, I'm Rob Mathias. I'm the host of the Rebel Love Show. I also do other forms of activism and whatnot, like Foundation for New Hampshire Independence and what else. I work in the telecommunications field. I also have a bachelor's degree from Purdue in computer information technology. I use technology a lot in all the activism that I do, and I kind of view it at the point where the Free State Project in itself wouldn't even exist if it wasn't for technology.
Absolutely. Great point. Denis, if you would.
So my name is Denis Goddard, and I am a director of software engineering at Oracle Corporation. And I've done a number of web-related things for various Free State Project things. Like, I was webmaster for the freestateproject.org website for a while. I set up the NH Common Sense marijuana advocacy website for a while. The New Hampshire Liberty Alliance bill review system is a thing that I've put together. So I try to do web stuff where it looks like it'll be useful where I can.
Absolutely, insanely important stuff. And I know, Denis, you've been kind of the man in the Free State Project. A lot of people describe you that way. So really, really an honor to have you on here. Why don't we get into the questions? And this is one I do want to address to all of you. And please be as brief as possible. But I think it's important. You know, a lot of people maybe are new to technology, whatever the case may be, and they're like, wow, you know, how does somebody even get involved in this? Or how does somebody, you know, get interested in this? And I mean, if you want to go to your, you know, describe it at your childhood level or at college or after college, whenever it was, I guess I'm asking, like, why is your butt in this chair? I know your jobs, I know who you are, but what got you into technology? Where did that passion come from? Because I think it does become a passion at some point. I mean, certainly when you consider Jeremy, you're working on, you know, an incredibly interesting decentralized project. And you know, everybody here, like, how did you get into technology itself? Stephanie, if you want to start it off, and we'll just go down the line.
Yeah, I can answer that. For a long time, especially, I've lived in New Hampshire for 10 years. I moved here in 2006. I was like a really early mover to the Free State Project. I think Denis was there before me probably on this panel. But for a long time, I was kind of struggling with like what I wanted to do and like what strategies I wanted to use to achieve liberty. I saw a lot of people like getting arrested and stuff, and I was like, well, that's really not for me. I don't think you can do much from a jail cell, and you're not very free. And then I saw like people working in the political system, and I tried that for a while, and I quickly realized like, no, that doesn't work. It's a totally rigged system. You're not going to make any meaningful change. And so I didn't have anything that I did for a really long time. And then I sort of started getting into aspects of personal freedom, and I looked at psychology and got into like just personal development. And technology, I think, falls into that realm of the personal, because technology is just a tool. It depends on how you use it, and you can use it to get more freedom, and you don't have to ask anyone's permission. All you need is like a little innovation.
And certainly our devices have made technology very personal when you consider the smartphone.
Yeah, it brings people together. I've met great friends through the internet and been able to maintain friendships over distances that wouldn't have been possible before. And there's just so many things. I'm able to work on the internet, which gives me a ton of freedom in my life. And I think it's like one of the major, one of the major things that affects my quality of life. So technology is really important to personal freedom, which I think is where it's at.
Absolutely great answer. Jeremy, please.
Well, I was fortunate enough in my household to have technology involved in my life from a very early age. So even though my dad and my mom weren't technology people, they were kind of geeks. And so we were on the internet in the mid-90s, you know, right, when there weren't that many people on the internet. And it was an incredible experience for me. It's how I got into all of these ideas, right? I wasn't learning about these kinds of ideas in school. I was learning about them on the internet. And I totally agree with Stephanie. I see technology as a tool. I'm not in love with technology for itself. I'm in love with technology in terms of how it can improve our lives and can make things possible that weren't possible before.
Yeah, tech is a tool. I absolutely love that phrase. Steve, why don't you go for it?
Well, as far as why my butt is in this chair, I've heard that it's thanks to a technology that was supposedly invented in New Hampshire, because supposedly the alarm clock was invented in New Hampshire. I don't know if that's true.
Someone and it's enslaved us all. See, that's why the Free State Project's here.
But I guess I'm kind of a geek. I guess I grew up right around the right time where the dot-com boom was happening. And so I'm basically old enough to remember that. But
yeah, that kind of put it together. I mean, when you're surrounded by that kind of
I'm a very very mechanical type of person and logical and stuff. So it's like if I wasn't in the dot-com boom, you know, if it wasn't formed by the dot-com boom, I probably would be doing something electrical or mechanical, or
you'd be an engineer.
I'd be some kind of engineer. Yes,
absolutely. Yeah, no, fair enough. Rob.
All right, well, how I got into technology. Well, for one, I grew up as a Trekkie. Like, I grew up with Star Trek in the household.
I think everybody here could raise their hand to that one.
So that really got, I mean, the fact that I'm holding a device, like, right here that is literally, a communicator from Star Trek, and then some, that I can literally, video call someone from the palm of my hand that's on the other side of the planet in real time, just blows my mind that I can even do that. I know, it's great.
Yeah, porn, there we go.
Beautiful device.
That's what tech's all about.
But I got really into technology via Star Trek, and I never kind of looked back. I don't dabble in like creating tech or writing code or anything like that. I'm not skilled enough to do that. I've tried it, I've taken classes on it. But I do always try to use technology as a tool to better my life and to create content, and pretty much everything I do revolves around using technology, from living here to finding this to pretty much my day-to-day. I'm always using technology in some sort of fashion or another, and I'm always willing to embrace new technology. I understand that there's always like a line in the sand for people, or like that it's too much for them to have in their life. But I will say there's some things I will not do, but do I have the front-facing camera on my phone cover? No, I don't. People do that. I love technology, and I try to incorporate that to just not better my life, but better everyone else's life.
Absolutely. Dennis, if you would.
So when I was in like fifth grade, my dad bought a computer, and this is way back when a computer meant we went to Radio Shack, and it had 80 by 24 with like one color, and later on we upgraded and you could get disk drives, and to add more memory, you used a soldering gun to put more memory in, and plus I was a libertarian.
Playing with the Altair, right?
Yeah. Trash 80. But I was a libertarian, and libertarians, some of you will be aware, not all of you, humans are weird and scary, right? And so we're introverted, and there were computers that you could actually make do what you want if you just spend hours and hours and hours working on them, and so that's very addictive. And then with the Free State Project, it was amazing to me how this is, 11 years ago, technologically backwards New Hampshire was. That may not surprise some of you. But even today, the groups that really are, in fact, changing the nature of civic society in New Hampshire, by which I mean the Republicans and the Democrats, were horribly backward. And there were fairly small, simple, easy things that it was possible to do by just throwing up a website that a lot of people just don't have that gumption or don't have that ability even today, so that you can start up a little campaign like notayacht.com. I was the webmaster for that one. Very easily, the simple things that we do, like with the Liberty Alliance, not that hard to do. Just about anyone with some coding skills can do them, and yet the Republicans and the Democrats aren't there yet. And there's a lot of opportunity for anyone that's got some technical savvy and some technical skill to leapfrog establishment even technological capabilities in New Hampshire.
Yeah, so effectively, tech is really giving people an edge in New Hampshire, absolutely. And that keeps you, you know, inspired to keep using it and all that. I think that's interesting. So, okay, well, let's get into the next question here. And this has to do with probably, I mean, this is something, the past couple of years at Keenevention, we've talked quite a bit about security issues, privacy issues. Of course, the Snowden revelations were very fresh at the time. And I do want to touch on that briefly, but then I want to get into other aspects, because where we can move forward from all of that. And the question is, I mean, that effectively, you know, considering these Snowden revelations, considering, I mean, and not just the Snowden revelations, I mean, you talk about what OPM is going through, where, you know, however many millions of, government employees had all of their data, you know, leaked. You know, I mean, there's just, it's nonstop. Every single week we find out about, you know, new privacy leaks, security leaks, you know, all kinds of this stuff. I mean, what, considering all that, what do you think is the importance of the Free State Project? I think Denis touched on it briefly, is that no one else is really using it. No one else has a clue. Clearly, the government en masse, minus maybe the NSA, doesn't have a clue about how these things work. But, I mean, you know, what is the importance of the Free State Project and with activism, you know, to keep on with technology and maybe not to, because I think some people want to shun it when you find out about these leaks. I think some people want to just, you know, go hide away in a cave. And like I said, I completely respect that opinion. I mean, at least, like, I don't blame you. So what is the real importance to, you know, and Stephanie, I know you said personal freedom, but maybe even beyond that a little bit, what is the importance of technology to the Free State Project and to activists in general here? What do you think? Actually, you know, Rob, why don't we start with you on this one?
All right. For me, technology is very important with the Free State Project. There's a lot of things that happen because of the Free State Project that could never have been planned prior to. So, for example, CopLock was founded here in Keene. Like, the whole idea of filming the cops and whatnot with your smartphone, using technology to, you know, stream that via Bamboozer or any other app to the internet, so it's already, that video file is no longer on that phone. It's also out in the cloud, so, like, literally the police, if they take your phone, they're not taking your video.
And that term CopLock is like an international thing now.
Yeah,
and it started
here. CopLock is way bigger than the Free State Project. Like, the whole notion of cop blocking and whatnot, that happened because the Free State Project existed, but wasn't an outcome that they wanted to happen. But that happened because of the easy to use and get technology. So if this was like 20 years ago, you're not going to see people running around with like huge cameras on their shoulder videotaping police. That's just, that wouldn't been a thing. So. Yeah, technology is very pivotal for the Free State Project and libertarians in general, because besides CopLock, like, I would say the amount of libertarians and anarchists that advocate and use Bitcoin wouldn't be doing so if it wasn't for the amount of people in the Free State Project pushing Bitcoin. So there's a lot of different technologies that come up and things that happen because of the Free State Project that, you know, wasn't the goal, or that wasn't the intent of what the FSP did. It was a side effect, something else that came out of people living here.
Yeah, I think it's a good point with Bitcoin, especially. In fact, there's statistics, there's numbers to prove it from Overstock, that part of the reason that Bitcoin being a viable purchasing power comes from the fact that a lot of people in New Hampshire were just waiting for somebody like Overstock or others to exist to be able to spend it with them. And then the numbers really show that that's where the bulk of the spending came from within like the first few months or to a year maybe. Steve Z, what do you got, any thoughts on how important, you know, technology is to the Free State Project, or maybe even in the inverse of how important is the Free State Project to technology?
I think technology is important to the Free State Project, basically, because I don't know if this thing would exist. I don't know if the Free State Project would exist if it wasn't for the internet, basically, because that's how I think most people have heard of it. I mean, we got Ian on National Syndicated Radio, but
yeah, I think a lot of people first heard Free Talk Live perhaps through the podcast, at least the people that are here. Yeah,
right. So that's about, you know, I think this would only come about with the internet, and I don't know, that's about it.
Sure, absolutely. No, Denis, do you have thoughts on this? I imagine you do.
New Hampshire is like Afghanistan. Your empires and your would-be invaders come here to see their dreams fail. And the Free State Project, in many ways, you know, has that to look forward to. unless the Free Staters become the Afghanis, become accepted into the tribe. And technology absolutely has a part to play in that, especially these days when typical people have a Facebook account. You know, your grandma has a Facebook account. Good, you can now interact with these people. As technologists, there are so many things that are happening at the state level that, again, if you don't understand New Hampshire, you don't even know that the battle is happening. Getting Bitcoin accepted as an officially recognized currency, as something that you could pay your taxes in, as something that you can pay your parking meter in, those conversations are happening right now in the State House. And they happen if people like us show up and just say, blah, blah, blah. The real ID thing, we stopped real ID in New Hampshire because of a lot of people's input. Those of us on the technology side had a lot to do with that. I was able to walk into the committee hearings and say, listen, Senator, I work at the world's largest database company, and we have teams of people in every time zone on Earth working 24/7. You know what they do? They fix bugs. So which database is this that you're going to put the information in that no one's going to be able to get it out from?
And they just go cross-eyed.
And show me the system that has no bugs. Show me the system that doesn't have a system administrator who, for $2 million and a ticket to the right country, wouldn't give you up every amount of information that you ever wanted. Don't make the database. Don't go there. Don't build the intelligent machine. And when someone who has the tech cred says that to the Senate, they go, oh, it really is that easy.
Yeah, absolutely. Jeremy, do you have any thoughts on this that you want to share?
Can I answer the inverse question? Because I find
that to be an interesting
question. Because, you know, something I can definitely speak to is it's absolutely nuts when, I'm on the business side of it as well, and like trying to figure out whether you're a criminal or not when all you're trying to do is go to someone else and completely voluntarily sell them a service. It's like, it's crazy. And you talk to lawyers and people like this who are, it's their job to know the law. And they're like, is this allowed? I'm like, well, maybe. How can I find out? You do it and then you find out what happens. I'm like, and it's crazy that there's no, I'm here trying to create products and create things for other people. And it's like, I can't even know whether or not I'm going to get in trouble doing it. And so, to have a space where it's just okay to do things, and there's not someone else who's going to come and get in your way. I think it's really important.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the technologies getting developed, I think, really need to be permissionless, because over the past decades, technology was very much permissionless. I mean, only now is, the NSA and other people setting up camp in Silicon Valley and other areas. And I think to have a community of people that can at least morally support you, even if they don't totally understand what library.io is, or what's going on at Oracle, whatever the case may be, to just have people that are like, I trust you, I get it, let's go forward. I think that is a very powerful thing to have that activism and to have that community around you to do it. Stephanie, if you had any thoughts?
Yeah, technology lets us be creative, and technology is always a workaround to the status quo, which is slow and lumbering, and you can't get anything done. I mean, you only need to look at Bitcoin to figure that out, right? Like, the problem is banks that won't let you have control of your own money and can just do, have all the power over you. And Bitcoin is a total run around that, and there's nothing anyone can do about it. It's just, okay, the technology exists now. The world has changed. There's no one to put in jail. There's no one to stop it. No one to go after. What about like ride sharing apps or Airbnb? The problem is, I don't want to deal with these taxis or these hotels. They're expensive and they're not giving me the service I want. And so, okay, we'll create a way to get around that. So yeah, it makes people's lives better and it's creative. And I think that's actually why it's such a natural fit for libertarians, because we're, I think there's sort of a personality type involved where we're just contrarian, and also like the logical, rational thing. We love computers, and so it meshes well together. And it happens to be a great, embracing technology happens to be a great way to change the status quo, or to force the status quo to change.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of us, especially libertarians, anarchists, voluntarists, whatever word you want to use, I think they naturally see how technology levels the pyramid of power. And it makes it so that you have, the same abilities, or the ability at least to defend yourself, or, in all various ways, from the encroachment of the surveillance state and all the banks even now. I mean, all kinds of things. It's really impressive. So let's go to the next question. And the question is, And if the answer is Bitcoin, just say Bitcoin, and then we'll pass off the microphone. But what do you consider the most important, and this could be software, hardware, whatever, what is the most important technological development you think? And, I mean, I would imagine that because it empowers individuals, so it's freedom-oriented in and of itself, that you think is out there today or that perhaps is coming very, very soon. And I mean, as in maybe there's like a set date or something along those lines, because some technologies, there's one called Xanadu, and I've been waiting. I don't know, how long was Xanadu announced, Dennis? Do you know? Do you remember Xanadu? Yeah, right. Yeah, it's also it's a tech. People have been waiting like 30 years for it.
Rush.
Yeah. Right. So anyway, so sometimes you're waiting for these things. So I like to talk about what's out there, what's actionable, what can people use. But actually, let's see, Jeremy, if you want to start off.
Sure. I mean, the answer is Bitcoin, but it's not Bitcoin. It's the blockchain. Right. I'm not actually personally convinced that Bitcoin will have a huge future, but I think absolutely we're going to see an incredible number of blockchain-based applications. And I'm not just talking about ones like Library. I mean, there's ones like Augur, like I think futures markets and the ability to bet, you know, basically price all these future events and bet on these things will be absolutely huge. And other ones like Open Bazaar and who knows what people will build, but I think we're going to see an incredible number of next generation applications built on top of.
Yeah, like Open Bazaar is a decentralized marketplace, very exciting. Why don't you take a moment, if you would, talk about library.io.
Totally, yeah, I just
and
didn't want to.
Because I think this is really important. Because yeah, there's things like YouTube and some of these other like really centralized content services that are a real problem.
Totally, yeah, I just didn't want. You know what the best new thing is? It's my thing. Yeah.
No, you can totally do that. You have no idea how shameful I am. You know okay. What I think the best new technology is my games. Go to zomiofflinegames.com and grab a couple of them. Go for it, Jeremy.
Sure. Okay. Well, so what Library is trying to do from the end user perspective, it's very simple. We want to give you guys a box, you type in it, and you're going to find whatever piece of media you want to find. A movie, music, books. We want all that stuff to be published on there. What powers it, though, wouldn't have been possible without the idea of the blockchain. What Library does is it takes all of the metadata, the information about content, right? So the name.
Metadata is data about data.
Data about data, right? But what does that actually mean when we're talking about content? It means what's the title? What's a short description of it? These kinds of things. You put that stuff in a blockchain. So there's no centralized repository of what data is available on the network. It's available. It's in the blockchain. And then the content itself, we distribute that across any computer that plugs into the network. So you can take your computer, you could run the Library application, and you could say, I've got 50 gigabytes, and you know, don't eat too much of my bandwidth, and make as many credits as you can with that space. So the network that serves all of this content is not, you know, there's no, right now all content is served in centralized fashion, right? And so all of these content providers build in parallel these really complex systems to serve this content. Content's really simple, it's a number. Right. And so what Library is trying to do is be a marketplace for numbers, and allow people to come and find things easily, quickly, and cheaply. One of my campaigns that I've been working with is, you know, we need to end number prohibition. Right. We need to stop making numbers illegal.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, it's a funny thing. Like with Bitcoin, I always say that we're, you know, I'm walking around with math. How could that possibly be illegal? And, well, somehow, or it's not illegal, but somehow it is certainly criminalized mentally anyway by a lot of people. Stephanie, if you want to go.
I'll just say Bitcoin.
Fair enough. That's all right. Steve Z, go for it. Most important technology you think going out?
Probably mobile broadband, cell phones, tablets, all these things that people have in their pockets. And just the availability of internet connectivity pretty much everywhere now, because I think that's where we've had the most change in our lives, in our everyday lives. Is, I mean, what kind of phone were you carrying around 10 years ago? Were you carrying around a phone 10 years ago?
Right. Yeah, I think that's a great answer.
And now we can watch YouTube. It's crazy.
So. Yeah, absolutely. Go ahead, Rob. Yeah.
I was just going to back Steve up on the exact same thing. I mean, cell phone technology, the easy use of broadband internet anywhere you go, pretty much on this planet at this point, is the most technological fundamental thing that's happened in human history. The fact that any one of us can literally look up any information we want at any time, anywhere, literally if we wanted to, just by talking to our phone, and it shows us that information. Or for some effect, on top of that, I know a lot of people hate Facebook and social networking and whatnot, but none of us in this room would be here right now if it wasn't for social networking and Facebook and other stuff where you found this or you make connections. Like, all that stuff happened because of social networking. We have the ability now where we have better communication skills in regards to technology than the President of the United States did back in the 90s. Like, we have, how you're saying technology is coming up where it is making the state obsolete. It sort of is, because you're getting, as much as the state tries to clamp down on technology and hold us back, at the same time, there's no way they can keep up with the rise of technology. And technology is also liberating the world. It's like everyone is coming to new ideas, new ways of thinking, and they wouldn't have that if it wasn't for the internet. Instead of having to rely on a newspaper or a TV show to give you information, you have the ability to look it up whenever you want to from the palm of your hand.
Absolutely. Denis, your thoughts? Most important technological development?
Oh, excuse me. I was just at the office for a moment while he was talking.
Point proven.
Let me relate this to New Hampshire. In New Hampshire, I initially would have said that the biggest technological thing was Pork 411 when that was first put out by Michael Hampton, who is an awesome guy. You'll run into him eventually. And the ability to just click a button on your phone and boom, your conversation is streaming to the internet and being broadcast to the entire port community. Fantastic, amazing, revolutionary thing. I'm not sure that that necessarily changed the culture in the state of New Hampshire, but it was a game changer for us. Honestly, in terms of changing the game for the entire state of New Hampshire and how things are going in the state, I'll actually go ahead and say the New Hampshire Liberty Alliance bill review system, which has made it possible to crowdsource libertarians reading all this legislation, having the libertarian bullet points of, for or against the legislation, and being able to put that in front of the legislators every week before they actually vote. The technology behind it, really, really simple. The effect is that the entire state of New Hampshire now has a libertarian bent, a libertarian influence in its lawmaking that no other state has.
Right on. So let's go to the next question. Does anyone have anything they want to respond to any of that? No? Okay. And the next question is, and this is a really important one, especially for people that want to come to New Hampshire, is jobs, right? I mean, I think anybody, you're going to move anywhere, you're wondering, what about jobs? Can I get a job there? What does all that look like? And I think with tech in particular, that makes an answer very dynamic. And with the Free State Project and its participants, you get a lot of proof of how this can really happen, even if perhaps there isn't some 9-to-5 that you can go to. Not that there's anything wrong with that. And so I want to hear everybody's take on this. And Stephanie, I think you have perhaps one of the more interesting outlooks on this, and it was a major reason why I wanted you on this panel. What are the options? Because not just of finding like a tech job, but maybe creating a job. And you've certainly gone through quite a process, and tech has totally made that possible. So I'm kind of curious to hear because you're a voice actor, smvoice.info, if anybody wants to hire her, and who wouldn't. And how did you create that? How did that come together? And then I want to hear from everybody else on this as well, but go for it.
Cool. Okay, so I was working in science. Actually, I was working on my PhD in biochemistry. And I mean, for...
You became a voice actor?
Yeah, it has nothing to do with it, right? You're like, what happened there? Well, first of all, I want to say, there are a couple of biotech companies in New Hampshire. And there's always... Now there's the ability to, just take anything that you would have done in a traditional legacy system. Like, even biotechnology research, you think, oh, you can't... I can't do that in my basement, right? Well, actually, you can. There's there's open PCR machines. There's open source, lab equipment that you can build yourself for a couple hundred dollars. There's the ability to like do things like extract DNA with like your blender, you know. You can use stuff around your house, especially if you just get creative. So there's really the potential now for people to just take these kinds of work, whatever your passion is, outside of the traditional legacy systems and not ask permission and just do it. So I guess I could have started a lab in my basement, but I wasn't really up for that, and I didn't really have like an idea that I really wanted to work on.
The smell could have been a little strange too.
That might have been a problem, yeah. We maybe needed some ventilation or something. Although sometimes when you look in the refrigerator, it's like you're growing something.
Yeah, it looks like a lab experiment at times.
Good thing Brian cleans my house.
But can we stick to the tech, please?
So anyway, I realized I just wasn't happy and I wanted to change careers. And I did a lot of soul searching. I did a lot of like listening to podcasts and reading Tim Ferriss's books and all that kind of stuff, the $100 startup. That's not Tim Ferriss, but you know, 4-hour work week and all that stuff. And I thought, you know, I've always said since I was a little kid, like I really want to do something with my voice. And I had a podcast as a hobby that I really liked. And I realized my podcast was giving me more joy than was like going to work in the lab every day. So I said, all right, well, you know, I'm just going to go for it. I want to be a voice actor. And this is where it gets really interesting, because I was able to set up a studio in my home, which has actually revolutionized the whole field of voice acting. It used to be that you had to have an agent and you had to like send a demo tape or maybe a CD back in the 90s to all these agencies, and if they liked your demo, they might pick you up, and then they'd farm you out to people for doing commercials, but then they'd take 10-15% of your talent fees. And then you, of course, you had to join the union, right? The Screen Actors Guild, SAG-AFTRA union, and you really couldn't compete outside of that. You couldn't really be an independent voice actor. But now you totally can. There's online casting websites where I can go and look at dozens of jobs every day, see which ones fit my voice, and audition for them from my home in my pajamas with equipment that I bought on the internet. Like, that's wild. It's so different from having to go through the agency and sending demo reels, like literal reels, to people. So, yeah, like audio equipment has gotten so much cheaper that now it has not only spawned a bunch of voice actors who work at home, but also people who have podcasts, people who produce audiobooks from their home, literally.
Yeah, I mean, you can get amazing sounding audio equipment for well under $100. All like a complete studio.
I don't know
studio.
About amazing.
Well, really good. I mean,
you can get sound equipment for under $100.
Yeah.
It won't sound amazing, but it's going to sound a hell of a lot better than just using like the internal microphone on your computer or something like that. And you can get amazing sound quality for a few $1,000s at home.
Sure.
And you can, you know, just take a spare room and repurpose it, put some foam up on the walls or hang some blankets. I saw a lady, I'm in a Facebook group for voice actors online, and there's one lady who was traveling. She had to finish recording an audiobook. She went to Walmart and she bought a portable closet. This is so creative. She bought a portable closet, which is like just, you know, some pipes or something, creates a little that you can walk into. And she hung blankets from her hotel room on the sides of the closet, and then she was using her travel microphone and her laptop inside that to create a portable sound booth for $12. So you really
can't beat
that.
Yeah, so I mean, I think you're really, really highlighting the fact that a lot of these jobs are, you know, the ability to do these jobs has been really democratized. You know, the ease to entry, like there's no barriers
to
entry like there used to be.
Have just been so lowered on all this kind of stuff, sound equipment, doing a podcast, being a voice actor, or working on the internet, which is something that I think is really, I think, overlooked by people in the Free State Project, because, you know, the Free State Project wants people to be in New Hampshire physically together. But honestly, now with Bitcoin, with the ability to have an online business where you can be location independent and you can have your websites and make money on the internet from anywhere in the world, I hate to say it because I don't want to piss anybody off, but like you almost don't have to be in a physical place. There's benefits if you want to buy eggs from your neighbor who has an organic farm or whatever. Yeah, you got to be in the same place. But if you want to have business relationships, friendships, perhaps even whatever, things that don't require sex or food, then you really don't need to be in the same place anymore because the internet brings people together. But everybody loves sex and food, so yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so I mean, and of course, having a community, especially if you want to do a create a job or create a technology kind of like what Jeremy's doing, you know, it's good to have that support structure. You know, so certainly being around people that support entrepreneurship, and definitely the attitude in New Hampshire is supporting entrepreneurship with agorism and all kinds of other things. You know, I think it's fantastic. So did you have any more thoughts you wanted to share on that, or we can...
I don't know where this comes from, but there's this meme going around of like, my country is the internet, right? You can actually really do that. You can do so much of your life online now. And it's not like, you know, people talk about virtual reality and they're like, oh, it's just escaping the real world. It's maybe even bringing Ayn Rand into the picture. Like, you're just denying the consequences of reality or something. But it's really not. It's just an other world. Like, the internet is another type of community and world and place to congregate. And you can make it your own, and you can have whatever parts of your life there that you want pretty much nowadays. And I encourage you to do so because you can get a lot more freedom that way.
Yeah, absolutely. I've made the case in the past to say that your computer is now your country. I mean, it's not. I'm not the first person to say that. That's an old cypherpunk adage from the 90s, but I think that's very, very true today. That's where you. I mean, and you have, you know, to use unfortunate terms. I mean, your computer has its own State Department. It's called a firewall and all this. I mean,
oh no, stop. Why don't we just say like your computer is your home or your domain or something?
I said they're unfortunate terms. So anyway. Jeremy, if you're all set, Stephanie, we'll go to Jeremy. Yep. And yeah, Jeremy, you're creating something here. So you're creating a job, but then also if you do have any thoughts on finding a tech job, you know, or go for it.
Well, I mean, sure. I mean, the wonderful thing about tech jobs is, I mean, you can do them from anywhere. With TopScore, we have people in San Francisco, Pittsburgh, Connecticut, and we all just sit in a chat room and do video chats, and we get together in person a couple of times a year, and it works well. And so there are a lot of jobs now where you have the potential to do them from anywhere, and so yeah, come and do them here. And I would love to see more people with a certain, you know, there is a lot of entrepreneurship here. I would like to see more sort of startup-oriented people here, people who are trying to not just do a business, but a big business. And I would encourage anyone who is interested in that kind of thing to reach out to me.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and actually, I want to ask you this, Jeremy, and maybe Denis can touch on this too. Like, what skill levels are do you think a lot of these like tech startups or tech related jobs are looking for? I mean, are they looking for people with the passion, or do they really have to have that genuine technical skill right out of the gate? What do you think?
I'd say you probably need to have the skills to get a job. There may be some places who would take a you know, a gamble on you if you're just on your passions, but no, you're probably going to need to have the skills. But the wonderful thing is you can develop the skills in your house via the internet. You don't even have to go to school. And I personally, we're probably a little bit weird here. I'm happy to take a look at you regardless of what your education is. I don't care if you have a computer science degree. We just hired someone who had a degree in chemistry, and he's going to be a programmer for us. And it's because, well, he's a good programmer. And I can look at his code, and I can read it, and it's good. I don't care what you got a degree in.
Absolutely. Denis, let's go to you. I mean, what's your overall take on the tech job scene?
I have no respect for anyone that asks about the tech job scene in New Hampshire because it means they weren't smart enough to go to freestateproject.org/jobs. And if you'll notice, many of the jobs there are, in fact, tech jobs. And all this, it's very nice highfalutin talk about entrepreneurism and stuff. The fact is, there are lots and lots of jobs in the tech industry in New Hampshire. And a lot of times, the reason a person can't find a job is that they're too good for the jobs that are available. There are a lot of jobs sitting out there unfilled in tech sales, in tech support, in design and testing. Large companies like Oracle, smaller companies like BAE Systems, Dyn DNS, companies like Liberty Mutual, these are all large tech hirers, and they hire people all the way from frontline support up through architecting systems. So it's there, and they're actually on freestateproject.org/jobs.
Yeah, absolutely. And actually, I'm glad to have you on the panel because I knew you could really, you know, lay out a lot of that. That is important. So, I mean, the fact is there are jobs here. Technology is empowering those jobs. I don't think some of those you described, Denis, do not require a whole lot of experience. Not at all, yeah. So that's a really important point to get out. I get it. People need to make money. There's no doubt about this. Rob, if you have any thoughts on this?
With tech jobs, I mean, how everyone was saying, go on the internet, get your skill level up there. Start doing something in that field that you want to go into. Like, don't wait to go to college or get some sort of degree, some piece of paper where someone says you know this. Like, go forth and actually learn how to get a skill or a trade in a tech field and go out there and sell yourself in that position. There's a lot of tech jobs in New Hampshire. I do want to touch back on what Stephanie was saying about the relatively ease of like creating a job where you can be from home, especially with like the technology in that area with you doing voice acting. We have our own studio as well, and hopefully one day we can make it to where we're making money and we can actually, like, you know, I can quit my job or something like that. That's a goal. I mean, I work in a tech field, but I still have to go to like an actual building. I would love to be able to not have to do that at some point in my life. But you know, all that, I mean, if you want to go in, into like podcasting and whatnot, or try and make that as a living, like the barrier to entry to that is so like almost disappear. Like it's so easy to buy all the tech that you need for a couple hundred bucks to do what a radio station or like a broadcast TV station would have done 20 years ago. And that's just one example of other ways that you can easily get into a field that you normally could never have got into like 10 or 15 years ago.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think this also illustrates the importance of having a community around you, because you're working a 9-to-5, but you want to build like this little media empire, perhaps, or a podcast, whatever the case may be, a YouTube channel. That can be very difficult to do on your own when you are, again, working a full-time job as well. And it's nice when you can find somebody perhaps to be a co-host with you or to offset some of the load of the creation of these, media ventures and whatever else. I mean, that's huge. And I can tell you, as a podcaster myself, I mean, I run a two-hour show by myself every week. When I have guests on, boy, is it a lot easier on me. I mean, I'll admit it. But I, you know, I'm doing it the way I want to do it. Go ahead, Stephanie.
Whose studio do you run that
I
show
use
out of?
There. Yeah. See, there's the rub. This is the beauty of community. Is I use, of course, Stephanie's studio for that, and it's fantastic equipment, of course. And in fact, this happens with Free Talk Live. The studios for Free Talk Live, a lot of people will use those studios to be able to do. I mean, you're talking nationally syndicated quality, hardware. Meant for that national syndication that you can take advantage of by being here. And I'm not saying everybody can do that, but I'm saying that those kind of abilities exist when you have something like the Free State Project, when you have a community like that that supports, that is willing to support you and help you out. And really, in many ways, make your dream come true with some of these jobs. You know, myself, I'll say, I started a game company about a year ago. And I have two games out now. And this is, I mean, you can't imagine. You know, the 9-year-old me is just clapping. Like, whoa, man, you're making video games. This is awesome, you know? I even made my latest one was called Ninja Trek. And, you know, I can just see myself years ago going, wow, you made a game about ninjas. This is great. So, all these things. But all of that wouldn't be possible if I didn't think that I had, this liberty-minded community and whatever else to kind of, back me up. And to sort of have maybe even perhaps a built-in audience or people to get feedback from, whatever the case may be. It's an absolutely wonderful thing. It's so empowering. Tech is just part of the picture. It's just a tool, like Jeremy said. It's just a tool. You got to have the other pieces, and that's certainly what New Hampshire very much allows for, I think, with this community. Steve, did you have any thoughts on this, or we can go on to the next question?
I always kind of thought it was funny that, like, you see these tech startups and stuff, and they tend to always be in like really expensive places. I always kind of think it's funny that, like, why don't some of these people in Silicon Valley, these venture capital firms, try to spend their money a little more wisely, somewhere with a little cheaper rent? And
I don't understand it either. It's an input, and they're spending a lot of money. I mean, I understand you do have an ecosystem out there, but you really, I find the best ideas online, not from someone I meet in person. And I actually don't understand why they are. It seems like they're just wasting money because it's so expensive to live out there.
Move some of your businesses to New Hampshire. There's some untapped talent pools, and it's still cheap enough to like the Boston area if you want to be near the big city or whatever. But I think it's a good place for a tech startup, and the business taxes and all that regulations much less for the most part in New Hampshire. Do it. bring it to New Hampshire.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a great point, Steve, that you bring up, and I imagine everybody would echo it. You know, one thing, I mean, just my own opinion, this, I mean, it's shared by all the panelists. I think Silicon Valley's in quite a bit of a bubble, and eventually that bubble's going to pop, and I'm very concerned about what that'll look like there when that happens. So if companies want to, you know, hedge against that, I think coming to New Hampshire, setting up base in New Hampshire is an excellent way for a lot of that to happen, to avoid that aftermath of what that could look like. So I think, yeah, absolutely. I really echo that. I am baffled that companies want to set up in some of the most expensive parts of this country. That's mind-boggling to me. So anyway, unless anyone has anything else, we'll move on to the next question here.
I do.
Oh, yep. Oh, we got all right. Yeah, let's go ahead and get into this.
Just to kind of get away from this a little bit, you don't have to be in the tech industry to use technology to work from home.
Absolutely.
In some other business. For my company, TriBridge, we basically support accounting packages, and I work from home. All of our accounting people work from home. We're all over the country, and we got accountants who know technology very little, but they can work from home. And that home could be New Hampshire.
Right.
So you can be all in a lot of other fields and not even hardly know any technology at all and still work from home and be in New Hampshire.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a really solid point. Thank you for that. All right, let's get to our last question here, and then I do want to get questions from the audience. And this question is what do you think is perhaps missing from the tech scene, perhaps, in New Hampshire? Maybe it's a technology you were hoping exists or hoping is coming. Maybe it's, you know, something that you know exists, but nobody's using it. And why don't we go, we'll start with Stephanie here on this.
Yeah, I would say just the the companies that could be taking advantage of the awesomely low rents here in New Hampshire.
Sure.
That's missing. And also, I would like to see more biotech and also just biohacker spaces, anything involved with biotechnology or like human life extension is another like huge thing that hasn't really come up yet. But that's something that I'm definitely interested in. Like, yeah, outlive the state, use technology.
Yeah,
to
science can be done at home now. Like,
yeah,
it really can. Technology's gotten to that point. And so you're saying, like, that's just missing.
Yeah, I think that's a little bit missing from New Hampshire. So I'd like to see more of that outside of the academia of, you know, Dartmouth and things like that.
Yeah, I think that's a great answer. Absolutely. Jeremy, go for it.
Is this another question where I'm just supposed to talk about library again?
Go for it, man.
No, I've only lived here for 6 weeks, so I don't have that much of an opinion yet. I do want to see more people coming here with big ideas. The inputs are cheap. There are a lot of great people here. There is a natural community who is very willing to consider your idea, to look at your idea. And you can do these things from anywhere. So, yeah, come do it here.
Absolutely. Z?
I guess I'll have to echo what I said before. And as far as, like, activism is concerned, one of the most brilliant ideas I've ever heard was if someone basically started a think tank for developing activist tools, where it was basically, you know, kind of like if anyone watches like Silicon Valley on HBO, the hacker hostels.
Oh, where, yeah.
Where it's basically, you know, you get free rent, but you get they get a portion of any businesses that come out of that
They get stock options, effectively.
Yeah, but I think one of the best ideas I ever heard, and it's not my idea, but if someone started something similar where it was nothing but getting people to sit there and develop activist tools for smartphones or whatever it may be to smash the state, so to speak.
Sure, build like a platform, perhaps, that these things could get built upon.
Basically, the idea was, you know, pay people. You could probably pay them next to nothing because they'd be willing to do it really cheaply if it's something they're passionate about. But they still need to live, so they still need to, you know, to have a roof over their head and stuff and some food to eat. But if they could basically have a place where they could develop and get paid to develop tools. They could probably do a lot more, you know, than funding a lot of political activism, or not so much political activism, but a little bit of money could go a long way in
sure.
such a thing. Because I mean, look at some of the technologies that have come out in the past couple of years that have been used, basically to change the lay of the land as far as smartphones and filming police and all that sort of thing.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think that definitely an interesting idea. I like the sound of that. Rob, go for it.
All right. In regards to what's missing in tech in regards to New Hampshire or whatnot, I would like to see more tech startups and all that jazz. My kind of big two things that I see tech-wise in New Hampshire that it can do better on, cell phone and internet speeds in New Hampshire, especially like a lot of areas in New Hampshire, even with Verizon or AT&T, like their network isn't what it could be elsewhere. I would love to be able to go anywhere in New Hampshire and have, you know, great LTE service, which isn't a possibility. I would also love to see more Bitcoin adoption by businesses in New Hampshire. Like, I already pay my rent in Bitcoin. I already buy a lot of my goods and services that I use on a weekly basis with Bitcoin. If I can get to the point where, you know, I'm only using Bitcoin all the time, not even using Federal Reserve notes, like, I would love to be able to do that, because then I wouldn't be using their money.
Yeah, I mean, New Hampshire's probably leading the way as far as like geographic areas that maybe next to Berlin that allow for Bitcoin payment, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, more the better, absolutely.
Well, one thing in New Hampshire, like the apartment that we found a couple months ago, we found it on Craigslist, and it was listed on Craigslist as, we accept Bitcoin for payment for rent. Like, where else in like in the country are you going to find an ad like that is for an apartment and, yeah, we take Bitcoin? Like, that happened in Manchester.
Yeah, that is pretty awesome. Dennis, I'm sure you have some great thoughts on this. What is missing in tech in New Hampshire?
So I don't particularly like Bitcoin, not because I don't like the idea of Bitcoin, but because I don't like the architecture or the implementation. I think the blockchain is a pretty fucked up way to do an online currency, in my opinion.
Says the guy from Oracle.
Yeah. Well, there you go. Having said that, I think that they're a lot better than dollars. And I think that having a lot of people in New Hampshire transacting using Bitcoin is unfortunately going to be extremely, extremely useful when the dollar goes tits up, and who knows what day that's going to happen. I especially want to call out and maybe embarrass a little bit. I just have this image of you last night in my head, and it's screwing up my... No, don't look around. What is your name? Derek. I want to call out Derek for helping a lot of people, just person to person. Hey, have you seen this cool thing? Let me help you download this onto your phone. Look how easy this is. That's what's needed in New Hampshire. New Hampshire is not about putting up a website. New Hampshire is about the person to person. I was just waiting in line. I was at the dump. I was at the gas station. And I showed this guy this Bitcoin thing. That will change this state.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think, you know, and that's a great point, Dennis, that you bring up, because I think a lot of people feel that technology just, removes that person-to-person touch. But in actuality, it can really bring us all kind of together like it has. That's kind of been a running theme here, is that a lot of people found out about the Free State Project because of technology, because of things like Facebook and others. And I'll touch on this, and then I want to get to questions from the audience. The thing that's missing for me, it honestly, is the use of encryption. It baffles my mind, and I have a Facebook account too, but it baffles my mind that people are talking about getting more freedom and ending the state, which thrives on surveillance, and they're using Facebook to do it, which is the largest surveillance net on the planet. I mean, that just baffles me to no end. I'm very pleased that some people are using alternatives to that as late, like Telegram, and, you know, there's no need to get into how good those are, perhaps. But getting away from a lot of these leviathans in the tech space, I think, is really important. I wish more people would get on board with this. Encryption, you know, privacy and security, privacy particularly is, if you want to use this term, is a human right. Security is incredibly important today, and it's harder and harder to achieve. And yes, people have to work for it. But the good thing is like, if people do, like Dennis was saying, where we have this, you know, conversation person to person, say, hey, could you check this out? Maybe you want to start using this. I hope that, like Bitcoin caught on like a wildfire in New Hampshire, that encryption technologies start catching on a lot more. And there's some good ones out there. Tor just came out with, that's the Onion Router, kind of the leading system that we have, the alternative perhaps to the internet that we have, even though it rides on its infrastructure. So it's alternative to the World Wide Web that we have that allows for, you know, anonymity, privacy, security, all these different things. They just came out with a Tor Messenger, which is fantastic. It's very easy to set up. A lot of these things are very easy to do now. The magic has come for encryption, and I hope that more people get on board with that. Everything should be encrypted. There's no good reason that it shouldn't. The only reason that it isn't is because the people that developed the internet and a lot of our communication structures that we have today, infrastructures, just didn't think about it. Like that, they, you know, and they'll even admit to you today that they wish they did, and they didn't. So anyway, that's that. If we could have a quick round of applause for the tech panel, and then we'll get into some listener questions first. Some audience questions. Yes, absolutely. Thank you all so much. That was great. So audience questions. We have Daryl here who looks like he's half the man he used to be. Go for it.
Long-time listener, first-time caller. Yeah. So I've got a quick criticism of techies in general. Uh-huh. Most techies, when they're putting stuff up on websites of instructions on how to do stuff, they tend to think that their audience is as intelligent as they are. So this is specifically aimed at the library guy. Can you please provide command lines to put into the terminal for those of us that aren't exactly tech savvy? I do run Linux, and like if I have instructions, then that's great. Right now it just says copy this and run, and I don't know how to do that. So instructions would be great.
Go for it, Jeremy.
Sure, absolutely. Well, that is very much my mindset as well. If you look at a lot of these other ones out there that are doing things in the blockchain space, they are super complicated. Libraries is trying to be very simple. We are in the early stages with it, so it's not as user-friendly as we want it to be. But the installer right now for Linux is just a shell script. It's just execute it. I'll make sure that the commands are explicitly labeled.
Yeah, if I had a command line on how to execute, that would be amazing.
Yeah, so I will change the instructions so that it just says, you know, make dir and then ./ run the script. But it's a two-step.
You forgot chmod plus x.
Oh, yeah, yes. Right, he's right. So, but thank you for that feedback. I absolutely will change that.
Yeah, I just want to say real quick, like Stephanie, you know, if you wanted to set up your own podcast, that had come up and things like this, or, you know, even this voice job, on smvoice.info, you have a full tutorial, what equipment to use, more or less how to set it up. I mean, even though, you know, with a lot of these ideas, like you have an XLR cable, it's pretty easy. You see three penis-looking things and
put
they go
into it. Tab
into
slot, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Daryl, I agree with you, actually. And so I've open sourced my studio. I have a page about how I've set up everything I have. And also, I like to give Bitcoin 101 talks to just talk about Bitcoin in a really simple way, help people set up wallets and stuff.
Yeah, definitely, you know, the ability to bring this down to where people can get their jumping off point and at least
I can't
you know,
run a command line.
Yeah. There it is. So, Daryl, do you have another?
Yeah, I've got a question for everybody. What, if you had to list like one or two sort of must-have cell phone apps for activists or some sort of program that would be easy for people to run, like, you know, what's your one or two must-have technologies?
I know what Rob's going to say. Tinder.
Yeah, that's the best one to have on your phone.
Go for it, Stephanie, if you have...
I really like Mycelium Wallet for Bitcoin because it has a local trader feature, like a local Bitcoins type thing, where you can buy and sell as well as a Bitcoin wallet. I'm going to have to think about the other ones.
Yeah, well, even if we go with one, that's okay. Jeremy, what do you think? The must-have app for smartphones.
And you can't say library.
Well, we don't have a smartphone app yet. You know what? I don't know if I have one. This is probably embarrassing, but honestly, the app that I open the most on my phone is Facebook.
That's embarrassing. All right.
That's how people do it here. I mean, I got added to, I think, like 8 secret Facebook groups. I'm getting added to like 2 a week, and it's my phone's constantly telling me to look at it now. So I can't stand up to it.
Well, you know, actually, Jeremy, in all honesty, this is something that a lot of people have either complained or... loved, is that if you want to know what's going on in the Free State Project, you pretty much, a lot of people feel you have to be on Facebook, because that's where all the events get posted, that's where all the calendars are, and all this. So to some degree, you may very well be absolutely right that that is the thing to have. Dennis, go for it.
NH calendar. You can't talk about the calendars without mentioning NH calendar, which you do not need Facebook for.
Thank God. Or, no, well, I don't believe in God, but thank you.
And as far as apps, it's not in the App Store, but gencourtmobile.com. Major shout-outs to Seamus Casey, who made this. gencourtmobile.com is very awesome. This is exactly the kind of thing that I promise you will change this state more than all the political parties put together, a little phone app.
Very good. So it's gen, G-E-N, court.com?
Gencourt Mobile.
Or gcm.io.
Does that do the same thing?
Yes.
Okay. All right. All right. There we go. Rob, thoughts?
Well, besides having Tinder on your phone, which all you guys should have Tinder on your phone.
Because he wants to get with you.
Well, you gotta branch out of the community and bring more people into the world, the whole world of liberty, And what better way to do that?
One big hug.
Yeah, go. Anyways. I think every activist should have a Bitcoin wallet on their phone, period. Like, that shouldn't even be in discussion anymore, but I still run into activists and free staters that, like, don't have a Bitcoin wallet. I'm like, how is that even a thing? How is that even possible? Because most of my transactions are, again, with Bitcoin. If we're really talking about how, we want to get the state out of our lives, what easy way than to do transactions with each other without using their money? That is by far the most important one that any activist should have on their phone. And again, Facebook. I hate Facebook, but the community lives on Facebook. If you need to network with people, get into groups, talk to people, see events. Yes, there's the NH calendar that Chris Lopez does an amazing job of doing, but you need to have Facebook on your phone too, unfortunately.
Z?
I just had to browse through my phone to give myself a reminder, and there's two apps on there that really stood out that you should have on your phone. Text Secure. And Redphone. Text Secure is basically encrypted text messages, and Redphone will basically make encrypted phone calls for you, as long as the other person on the other end is running one of those two pieces of software. And they're both free. I think it's from Whisper Systems.
Open Whisper Systems. Moxie, Marlin, Spike.
They got bought by Twitter, who made it free, if I remember correctly, correct?
I didn't hear about that.
Okay. Well, it's free. Install it. It's
great.
This
is bad. You might not want to listen to Sovryn Tech now.
Also, Mycelium is great Bitcoin client. Even if you're not really a big Bitcoin adopter, it's really nice if because I've been places I've owed someone like $3. It's like, well, I don't have $3. All I got is a 20, and no one has change, and it's so much easier to just send them $3 worth of Bitcoin.
Sure. Absolutely. Yeah, good answers. I will definitely second the use of Text Secure. It is definitely the gold standard of encryption. If you're on iOS, it's called Signal, and it has both Text Secure and Redphone built into that, but it's the same company. And eventually, Text Secure is going to have Redphone rolled into it. I am aware of that. I would say that Telegram is an important app to have. That's something that a lot of people, I'm going to take some credit for getting everybody on board with that. It is an encrypted messaging service. It has a whole bunch of features, allows you to even transfer files like up to a gigabyte. I mean, it's insane what you can do with it. And it is completely cross-platform, works on pretty much everything, even on a website. So I recommend looking into that. I guess the other one I would recommend is using Firefox. If you have, now I think they did just come out with a version of that for iOS, but if you're using Android, I consider it the single most important piece of software you can put on your phone. Because a lot of these things, websites that you go to, a lot of these various apps that you can use, you could just use their websites and you don't have to install their app that wants to access your camera or whatever other information you happen to have. And Firefox equally, while it could run those websites, it also uses independent certificate authorities from the rest of Android, from the rest of your phone. So if something goes wrong in Firefox, it doesn't affect the rest of you, or something which is the more popular thing to happen because Google is Google and they're rough at what they do. Firefox will protect itself from everything else that's going on your phone. This has been a real serious issue as late, so I definitely recommend putting the Firefox web browser if you have an Android phone on there.
I'm surprised nobody mentioned Cell 411, which is like Peacekeeper, only 1,000 times better. CELL 411. They're actually doing a fundraiser drive now to where the app will be free instead of like 99 cents in the App Store.
Okay, how much are they paying you? No,
they're not paying me at all.
All right.
It's absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
And then final question, we're all libertarians and anarchists because we absolutely hate roads. So techies, when will we have self-flying cars?
I'm gonna take this one, and actually, like, and it's a great question. It's very funny, but I'll give you the very serious answer. As long as there are nation states, they'll never happen. I think the reason that there are no self-flying cars is because of borders. They, like, governments do not want you to have the democratized ability to just fly over a border at any given moment. So I think that's the genuine answer to that question. Does anybody have anything quippy that they want to say to that, real quick? Well, I want to get to the rest of the people here. No? Okay, good. So this is why you listen to Sovryn Tech, because I know everything. All right. go for it.
I just had a comment. Stephanie, you were very inspiring. I didn't know I was going to come and be very inspired by the tech panel this morning, but I was. I love what you said about technology kind of giving you personal freedom from a job you weren't very happy in, and technology gave you the ability to make that change, and I'm kind of having that same realization. And if it's something other than just code, because, you know, you hear all this code, engineer stuff, but, you know, you did something very creative and unique. You became a voice actor, and I think that's amazing. I think that's very inspiring. You know, we may not all have chemistry degrees, but there's plenty of other things that the internet and technology can offer you. And then my second thing was just about way back. You guys were talking about how, like, easy and efficient it is to just create a studio. Me and Rob have a studio in our home. We have two working green screens that we bought, what we painted on for $20. $20. and they're both amazing. So that just is a testament to how far we've come since, you know, when you couldn't just do that. But yeah, that's it.
Yeah, thank you, Anne.
So you can be podcasting from the moon for $20. Thanks so much, Anne. I really appreciate it. I'm glad that was inspiring for you, and good luck in your journey as you get going, maybe change careers. Yeah, we'll talk.
Yeah, I think, you know, with the green screen thing and all this, and even with the podcasts, you know, I know a lot of people are like, oh, everybody has a podcast. Well, everybody's statist. So if you want to make a podcast, okay, please do so. Just do it. The more of those voices that can get drowned out, the better.
I do want to add something to that.
Please.
In New Hampshire, it's kind of like the podcast mecca for liberty activists, where there's multiple studios all around the state. So if you're coming here and you want to do something like that, it's really easy just to learn the trade of doing that. Just contact. I mean, I would gladly show someone what I do with my setup, what equipment I have. Every time I'm ever in a social situation with other podcasters, which seems to be a regular occurrence here, a lot of times we instantly just start talking shop, like, you know, oh, what mixer are you using? You know, how are you broadcasting? And what application are you using? It's that kind of community really helps you build up your podcast and put production values in that you may not have access to, regardless of, like, socially. It's one thing to learn on the internet. It's another one where you have another person sitting next to you showing you, this is what I'm doing, this is how I do that. But it's easily to do here in the Shire.
Absolutely. Next question. Go for it.
All right. My name is Brian Henschy, and I used to work for Oracle as a sales engineer, and I
Are you a doctor, or do you just play one on Halloween?
I'm a surgeon, just okay. On the weekends.
Right.
So really what it comes down to is my question is that I've lived here for about 2.5 years. My first year I was working for Oracle in Burlington, Mass., commuting down the over the border. And then I got laid off, and then I was essentially out of work for almost a year. I do hardware and software support and whatever. So my question for you is, other than the 13 young professionals organizations around the state, what do you recommend for ways to meet people in technology in particular to hopefully land a job, which is what I desperately need right now?
Denis, can you hire this man?
Yeah, seriously, if you're looking for a job, a couple of things are, number one, lose whatever specialization that you can. You know, if you've been doing tech sales for Oracle, first you're used to being abused, so that's a skill that not a lot of people are always that good at. but like apply everywhere for everything. As you know, like, you know, with Oracle, getting into a company, especially if it's a large company, that often is an introductory thing where now it's, now that you have a job there, it's much easier to go and do whatever it was that you actually wanted to do, even if it's in some completely unrelated thing. So like I say, I know that, I mean, I really only know Oracle's hiring situation in a given moment, but always in the Nashua office and in some of the branch offices down in Mass, they're always looking for people to do testing, frontline tech support, and often sales, except with sales, you have to enjoy getting whipped, which is not fun.
Fair enough. Did anyone else have a thought on that question? Or
sometimes HR gatekeepers can be terrible. So it helps if you, I mean, sometimes it helps to reach out directly to people. When I was looking for a job, I always found that I got along much further in the process if I was applying directly to the IT manager instead of going through an HR gatekeeper, which is unfortunately the case most of the time. And I think if you're in the hiring position, I think you're almost better off doing your own recruiting if you, you know, you're a small company and like looking for IT people or something like that. Yeah. Do your own recruiting, please.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and speaking of that, actually, Steve, I know you were for a while there. I mean, there wasn't like grand attendance, I guess, eventually, but you were doing a 2600 meetup in New Hampshire. And I think things like creating meetups for tech savvy people, and 2600, if you don't know what that is, that's what this hat is here. It's called the Hacker Quarterly. And it is a magazine that's been around for decades. And it's all about, you know, a lot of what we're talking about here in many ways, just not so New Hampshire specific. I think, you know, creating like tech meetups of some kind would be a really interesting thing to do as well. So
I do want to share a funny story about that. I mean, not so much the 2600 meetings, but there are a lot of meetups in New Hampshire. And one of the funny things that's happened to me was I heard about a Drupal meetup group in Manchester. I'm like, oh, I'll drive out to Manchester. I'll go check out the Drupal meetup group and see what. And I'm not a heavy Drupal developer.
Yeah, Drupal is
like
for
that.
Developing websites. Yeah.
I walk in and I see someone I know from the Free State Project, and I sit down and start talking. I'm like, oh, I didn't know you were here. And then basically the whole meeting was basically Free Staters, and it was just a really funny story. And if you look around, there are some networking opportunities. For me, it hasn't really panned out too well, but I mean, okay. I've at least met people, which is nice, and they're kind of, and the events can still be fun. Like there's if you're in like systems administration type of roles, there's if anyone's heard of Spiceworks, they have they basically make some network management software that they release for free, and it's basically mostly ad supported, but there's a huge community around the software where people ask all kinds of generic IT questions, and it's becoming one of like the leading IT websites in the world now. But they have a meetup in New Hampshire, they have a meetup in Boston, they have a meetup in Vermont, but way up north. But
excellent.
So check out, look around for events. There's plenty of stuff going on. But it's, you know, like I said, sometimes it's just a matter of time.
Yeah, time and place. Go for it.
Just to add something in, if you guys think of something later in terms of answering like what networking meetups and groups and whatever there are, maybe some people don't know, but there's FSP Job Alert on Facebook, FSP right. For Free State Project Job Alert.
That's so how you guys... I got my job was through FSP Job Alert. That's how I got a year ago.
Oh, cool. So I'm active on that. So if anybody has thoughts, networking groups to recommend to meet technology people, FSP Job Alert, I'd appreciate any leaks.
Share it there. All right, next question.
I'm curious, everyone's thoughts on the intersection of tech and the law. How much energy should we spend worrying about compliance, regulation, laws? Should we ignore? I know the Bitcoin community, mostly a year ago, but still kind of today, was split by this whole BitLicense thing where New York decided that they're going to regulate the hell out of it. How much should we care about what they think? How much should we just go around?
Go for it, Dennis.
It is very important to understand that in New Hampshire, small groups of people completely change the legislative landscape on a regular basis. Like, forget whatever programming, whatever like learning that you did, wherever totalitarian state that you came from. And Afghanistan's not like that, and you can't fight that war here. It sometimes takes 2, 4, 6 years of just being there in front of the committees and just helping them get it in their heads, and especially the Science and Technology Committee, which is like the slowest and, I'm sorry, least tech-apt people in the House. But absolutely spending time and effort educating specifically those folks, because it's about 24 people that are going to determine the nature of the landscape for adoption of alt currencies, ripping back regulations. These are not done at the local level in New Hampshire. These are done at the state level. And it's an extraordinarily open process. And if you're willing to just talk and give the bullet points and help educate these folks, that has enormous payoff.
Sure. Jeremy, do you have any thoughts on this?
Sure. You can't ignore the law. It's unfortunate that you can't ignore the law, maybe, but you can. If you're starting a business and your business's strategy is I'm going to try to ignore the law, you've put a significant ceiling on your business, and you've put a ceiling on your ability to get investors involved in your business. I'm not saying that I'm personally against those kinds of things, but I mean, if you're trying to succeed, it's strategically a bad idea. That said, it's also a bad idea to try to follow the letter of every single law, especially when you're a new company, or you'll never get anywhere. You can't ignore all the laws, there's a middle path. There's some things that maybe you can ignore when you're starting, but you have to understand that you are going to be subject to them if you're in any way successful. So you have to consider them.
Sure. Stephanie, do you have any thoughts on this? Is there anything you want to share on it?
Yeah, I would say do what you need to do to protect yourself, and maybe choose, like, if you can, choose areas that you're not going to be bothered. Like, for instance, I mean, I don't have much to worry about as a voice actor, like, unless someone sues me or something for a bad voiceover. But, yeah, like, do what you need to do to, like, protect yourself and avoid, but don't, like, do things that invite them in. Like, for instance, I wouldn't put any energy into trying to get the government to, like, let me pay my taxes in Bitcoin. I don't want to give them my Bitcoin. No way. Like, or I don't know, like, getting into some of these things like blockchain IDs and things like that. Like, I don't know, just don't really excite me. So my strategy is just to try to avoid and not to invite them in. We hear about this like blockchain alliance, you know, that just formed in the Bitcoin world, where there's companies that are like voluntarily like chatting and getting buddy-buddy with all the regulators and government people and FBI and CIA and IRS and all the alphabet soups. And I just think that's a terrible idea that nothing good can come out of. Just try to be left alone as much as you can. That's what we all want in general, right? So apply that in your business.
Sure. Dennis, let's go to Dennis and Jeremy.
I just want to call you out a bit, Stephanie, on that malarkey. If some other state came out and said, you know what, we accept Bitcoin here, you can even pay your taxes and your bus fines here, that would be a win for Bitcoin in that state.
No,
I want every win for Bitcoin to
be in
New Hampshire.
That's not a win for me. We just disagree on that, Dennis, I guess.
What I was going to say is that, you know, as an entrepreneur, and if you're interested in entrepreneurship, if the world was already perfect and as efficient as it could be and everyone had everything that they wanted, you would have nothing to do. So a lot of people get upset at the government and the things that it does. If I'm going to put an optimistic spin on it as an entrepreneur, the government's creating opportunities for me. If the government's going around and making things more efficient and doing things in bad ways, that's an opportunity for you to build a system that's better and to make some money doing it, if that's what you're interested in. So, we can sit here and get mad at the government, but I'm going to be honest, the government is also here creating business opportunities for me by doing a bad job. So.
I'll just make the last comment on that. I mean, I think that developing technologies that just end run the whole damn thing is really a wonderful thing. And asking for permission, you know, the old saying goes, don't ask for permission, ask for forgiveness. But don't even do that if you don't have to. Run away. But I think that's really the shtick, is to build these technologies that just make all of this completely obsolete. Bitcoin is doing that. I think that's, and many others, it's not just that. I know that keeps coming up. That's where I would be concerned. And the governments all over are, like Denis has been saying, are so far behind in how what to do with these technologies that you can get so far ahead to where they can't do anything about these technologies, more or less. I mean, the threat of violence is always there. And you could develop something really beautiful before they even know you exist, in my opinion. And so I recommend doing that. Now, if you're trying to create a huge business, of course, you know, things that Jeremy's has said, you know, are totally understandable. But like Stephanie said, you know, be safe, do what maybe makes you happy, things like that. And Denis, I got to say, I'm definitely on board with the notion that, yeah, don't pay those taxes, or, you know, with Bitcoin or whatever. Just avoid the whole thing altogether. So, but, you know, I love having the differing views on this panel. Do we have one more question? Okay.
Yeah, I have a question to Denis and maybe to Aza about Silicon Valley and why we can't have it on East Coast. There is a legal theory that in California, it's actually people have freedom to switch from one company to another. Like when people go to work, they sign different NDA and not sharing expertise. But in California, since old age, they have laws that one can't stop employer from going to another company. So this NDA actually got void if people like working for Oracle and there is some exciting startup, they can actually switch, but in other states, people need wait like 2-3 years before they can go to another similar tech company.
Oh, I see. So the concern is that, or did you get it, Denis? I mean, the concern is that you won't be able to like leave a company and just get another job. Is that the shtick?
And I was in Silicon Valley for 10 years before I got the easiest pay raise I ever got, which was to simply not have to pay California income tax anymore and move to the Free State Project. But the answer to the question is network effects. There's a reason why people pay the stupid prices for everything in California. The space, the developers, they want more than like 5 guys in Bangalore. Geez, I'll take the 5 guys. But it's the network effects. And it's part of the same reason that New Hampshire is such a great strategy, that the Free State Project is such a great strategy, is the network effects of just having more libertarians. The fact is, a lot of us who moved early were able to do so because of technology. We have a very tech heavy concentration here. The nature of network effects is you get this nice parabolic n squared thing that goes up. Once we hit that J in the hockey stick that I think we're kind of starting to see with folks like Jeremy, a lot of what people on the seacoast are doing, I think that you will likely see something like that here, and maybe we can have a bubble here too.
Yeah, hey, I'll take a bubble. It's a good problem to have, right? Or at least something close. Anyway, does anybody else have any thoughts on this? If not, we will wrap this up. Z, did you have something?
I was going to say, I think like courts all over the place have ruled that most of those are bogus. You have to check your local jurisdiction. I don't know about New Hampshire, but...
The NDA stuff?
NDA is one thing, but...
Non-disclosure agreement for those that don't.
Non-compete is what is usually considered what I think Yuri was talking about.
Okay.
And non-competes, basically, I've heard, are usually struck down.
Sure. All right. Jeremy, do you have a thought?
Well, yeah, it's something that hasn't been actually brought up yet that I should have mentioned at some point, having been here for a short amount of time. It's really cool that there are people like Denis, and there are 15 legislators here in New Hampshire that are interested in the Free State Project, and you can go and talk to someone who actually like makes laws, which is really crazy to me because that was never something that I was ever able to do any other place. So.
Sure. Stephanie, I thought I saw you reaching for the microphone at all.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Gary, but I think you were saying there's like an opportunity for New Hampshire for companies in New Hampshire to incentivize people to move here and build companies here because they wouldn't do, shenanigans like putting in place these non-compete agreements and dealing with the high rent, right? So we have an opportunity to attract tech. Is that what you're saying?
The question was more like that California has this law which overrides non-compete agreement. Does it make sense to have such law in New Hampshire or not?
Oh, I don't think it makes sense to have any law.
Laws don't make sense. that's the bottom line right there. So
maybe someone else can answer that.
No. anyway, that's it. The tech panel. Thank you all so much, panelists. And thank you, great audience.
Keenevention is brought to you by Roberts & Roberts at rrbi.co when you're serious about precious metals. We don't feed the banks. Bitcoin payment preferred. Online at rrbi.co.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.